Hi everybody, welcome to micro lecture number 5, Absolutism and Constitutionalism in Europe. During the 17th century, Europe experienced the consolidation of two very distinctive political regimes, absolutism and constitutionalism. In an absolutist regime, rulers claimed that God chose them as their representatives and only needed to answer to him. In this system, the monarchs claimed the absolute authority to make and enforce laws, and there were no other institutions that could balance or check their power. Although the system was quite strong, it was not perfect since the rulers needed to negotiate and compromise with powerful elites to maintain legitimacy. The countries we can mention as the main examples of this form of government during the 17th century were Spain, France, and Austria. In the case of Spain, despite having millions of tons of silver from the South American Andes, the state had weaknesses. The empire was vast and diverse. It combined different kingdoms, each with their own traditions and loyalties. Additionally, the industry and finance in the country remained underdeveloped. The empire's limitations became apparent during the first half of the 17th century. Between 1610 and 1650, Spanish trade with the colonies in the New World fell 60% due to competition from colonial industries and Dutch and English traders. Also, after 1630, the American mines start to run dry and the quantity of metal produced steadily declined. In Madrid, the expenses of war and imperial rule regularly exceed income. Despite the crown's efforts, it proved impossible to force the reign's different kingdoms to pay for the excessive military expenses. To meet state debt, Spanish crown repeatedly devalued coinage and declared bankruptcy, resulting in the collapse of national credit and steep inflation. Even though the economic crisis hit everyone in the empire, the aristocrats demand more money from peasants and also impose heavy taxes. They wanted to maintain their extravagant lifestyle, a move that proved to be problematic in the long run, since the attempt to draw more money from the peasants was detrimental to Spain's agricultural productivity. Additionally, Spain did not invest in technology or manufacturing and fell behind other nations like England or Holland. Spain's situation worsened after the defeats during the 30 Years' War, and after losing their grip on Portugal, the era of Spanish domination in Europe ended in 1688. France, on its part, was the largest and most populous state in Western Europe, but at the beginning of the 17th century, its position appeared to be extremely weak. After decades of religious civil war, the country did not have enough power to rival Spain. In practice, the country was ruled by Cardinal Richelieu, who was the prime minister and governed on behalf of Louis XIII, son of Henry IV, the founder of the Bourbon dynasty. Richelieu designed policies that reinforced royal control but failed to achieve the peace and stability that French people wanted. During the reign of Louis XIV, also known as the Sun King, the French monarchy overcame weakness and division to become the most powerful nation in Western Europe. Louis based his authority on the principle of divine rights of kings, which claimed that God had established kings as his rulers on earth. However, Louis also recognized that kings could not only do as they pleased, but they also had to work in favor of the people. Louis XIV was a hard-working king who claimed to lead by example. French people admired his discipline and hard work. He also insisted that religious unity was necessary for the development of the state. Thus, he ended up expelling more than 200,000 Protestants. One king, one law, one religion was his motto. Louis kept France at war for 33 years of the 54 years of his rule. During his time, France organized a professional army by tripling its size, standardizing uniforms and weapons, and creating a system of training and promotion. Most European countries later emulated his model in what today is known as the military revolution. France's ability to build armies and fight wars depend on a strong economy. To have that kind of wealth, Jean-Baptiste Colbert, the Controller General of Finance, organized a series of public policies that apply mercantilism in the country. Mercantilism is a collection of governmental policies for regulating economic activities by and for the state, intending to increase state power. It derives from the idea that a nation's international power is based on its wealth, specifically the supply of gold and silver.
to accumulate wealth, a country always had to sell more goods abroad than it bought from foreign countries. In France, the policemen created new industries, regulations, guilds, tariffs, and stimuli for foreign workers who wanted to live in France. In 1663, Colbert founded the Company of the East Indies with hopes of competing with the Dutch for Asian trade. Absolutism was also the dominant form of monarchical rule among the more than 1,000 states that composed the Holy Roman Empire. In this empire, the dominant power was Austria, led by the Habsburg dynasty. Austria was especially important even though the reign was not victorious during the 30 Years' War. They expanded east instead of west by conquering Hungary and Transylvania. The Habsburg made significant achievements in state building, formed alliances with the Catholic Church, and created a sense of identity by making German the official language and transforming Vienna into the official and cultural center of the empire. Most European nations during the 17th century were absolutist regimes, but there were two significant exceptions, England and the Netherlands. These two countries evolved towards constitutionalism, which implies government limitation by law and the balance between authority and liberty. In the case of England, after years of conflict, in 1688, the country's leaders settled on a lasting political solution, constitutional monarchy. Under this government system, England retained a monarch as the head of the state but placed sovereignty in an elected parliament. The political changes in England were the consequence of religious conflicts exacerbated by economic distress caused by several climate changes and diseases like the plague. The English Civil War, 1642-1649, was the confrontation between the king and the parliament. Led by Oliver Cromwell, a member of the House of Commons and a Puritan, the Parliament's army managed to control the government, forcing a protectorate with the characteristics of a dictatorship. Reflecting Puritan ideas of morality, Cromwell's state forbade sports, kept theaters closed, and rigorously censored the press. He died in 1658, and shortly after, in 1660, England restored the monarchy. In 1689, the Bill of Rights was passed by the Parliament. It established the independence of the judiciary and mandated that there be no standing army in peacetime. The bill also gave Protestants rights while also negating them to the Catholics. On their part, the Dutch reject monarchical rule in 1648 after gaining independence from Spain. Instead, they adopt a republican form of government in which elect representatives held supreme power. Dutch ideas and attitudes play a profound role in shaping a new and modern worldview. Global trade and commerce brought the Dutch the highest standards of living in Europe and maybe in the world. The moral and ethical basis of Dutch commercial wealth were thrift, frugality, and religious tolerance. In the Dutch Republic, political and religious tolerance seemed the right way and attract foreign capital and investment, making it one of the most powerful empires on earth. The evolution of absolutism and constitutionalism politically define the 17th century and are central to the understanding of the modern world. This is all we have for today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.